Remember, remember the 5th of November, gunpowder, treason, and plot. I see no reason why gunpowder treason should ever be forgot. You see, I remember that from when I was a kid. And of course, on the 5th of November in Britain, you have this extraordinary popular festival with bonfires and fireworks and barbecued sausages and so on. Celebrating what? Who is this mysterious Guy Fawkes, whose name is remembered for the last 300 years? Since that day in 1605, when Guy Fawkes was arrested, was discovered in possession of, or looking after, I think it was 36 or 37 barrels of gunpowder, which were destined to blow up the Houses of Parliament. I note that it has become fashionable these days for demonstrations all over the world, in fact, for people to wear masks of Guy Fawkes, who is generally quite often referred to as the only man that ever went to the Houses of Parliament with honest intentions. That's a little bit cruel, perhaps, but nevertheless, his intention was quite clear, declared. He admitted this, of course, under torture. His intention was what? It was to blow the whole of the British political establishment sky high. There was enough gunpowder there, of course, in this plot. It was an actual plot that undoubtedly did take place, to blow the whole of the House of Lords, it was actually, to blow it to smithereens, to blow it to high heaven. Had he succeeded, by the way, or had they succeeded, because he wasn't acting alone, it would have dealt a shattering blow against the whole of the British, English rather, political establishment. The intended act of terrorism, that's what it was, the intended explosion, was timed to take place on the 5th of November, at the time of the state opening of Parliament, when the House of Lords would be full of the English aristocracy, the King of King James the First, the aristocracy, the clergy, bishops, lawyers, judges, and so on. Yes, they'd have all been sent to meet their maker in double quick time. What do we know about this Guy Fawkes? Well, not a lot, as it happens. We don't even know what his real name was. It might have been Guido Fawkes. We don't know. When he was arrested, he gave the name of John Johnson, which of course was a false name. We also know that he was from the north of England, Yorkshire, I believe. And we also know that, very interesting fact, that he spent some 10 years as a soldier fighting in the Netherlands on behalf of Spain, Catholic Spain, to crush the revolt of the Dutch people, the revolt of the Netherlands. Now, we have to put this in context, in its historical context. This, of course, the period that we are dealing with, this period, is the period of the final decay of feudalism and the rise of the bourgeoisie, the age of the bourgeois revolution, or rather the earliest phase of the bourgeois revolution. The first bourgeois revolution actually was not in England, as many people assume. It was actually in Holland, where the Dutch bourgeoisie in the 16th century staged a revolution. It was a revolution, no doubt about that. But it took the form of a national liberation struggle against Spain. Protestant, Calvinist Holland rose up in arms against the domination by Catholic Spain. And therefore, the bourgeois revolution in Holland took a religious form and also the form, as I say, of a national liberation struggle. This was quite a ferocious struggle, by the way. Not much is known about this, unfortunately. It took a ferocious struggle At one stage, if I remember correctly, Philip II of Spain actually condemned the entire population of Holland to death, with exceptions. During this ferocious struggle, religious struggle, it was a capital offence to have a Bible in your house. You can be executed just for possessing a Bible in Holland at that time. If you were caught as a Dutch Protestant, as a heretic, by the Spanish Inquisition, of course you'd be tortured in order to elicit a confession. And if you confessed your sins and apologized and embraced the Catholic religion, then the Inquisition was merciful, insofar as you wouldn't be burnt at the stake. If you were a man, you'd be beheaded, and if you were a woman, you'd be buried alive. This is the kind of monstrous regime which you had under the rule of the Spanish Inquisition in the Spanish Netherlands at that time. Well, this Guido Fawkes, or Guy Fawkes, as I said, fought in Holland, whereas England, Protestant England, it was Protestant at that time, generally supported, even with armed contributions, they supported the Dutch Protestant revolt. This Guy Fawkes, this Guido Fawkes, fought on the other side. It's a little bit like the Spanish Civil War, where people, left-wing people fought for the Republic, but also right-wing fascist elements and so on from England and Ireland actually fought on Franco's side. Well, if you like, Guy Fawkes, or Guido Fawkes, whatever his name might have been, must have been a fanatical Catholic that fought on the side of reaction in Holland. Now, what bearing has this got on England? Well, of course, in England also there was a religious reformation of a rather peculiar sort. It wasn't the same kind of thing that you had in Europe, where Luther and Calvin, at least initially, did launch a kind of revolutionary struggle, at least in the first instances, against Catholicism, which of course was the ideological bulwark of the feudal order at that time. And therefore you could say that the bourgeois revolution at that stage was dressed itself in religious clothing as a Protestant anti-Catholic movement. But in Britain the situation was somewhat different, quite a lot different. The English Reformation was carried out by King Henry the Eighth purely for dynastic reasons. He wanted a son and heir in order to consolidate his own position and that of the Tudor dynasty, which was a relatively new affair, which had been introduced by his father, Henry VII. Since the Pope, for political reasons, refused to give Henry a divorce from his Catholic wife, from his Spanish wife, Catherine of Aragon, in order for him to marry Anne Boleyn, he broke with the Church for that reason. Not initially for religious reasons. As a matter of fact, if one looks at the doctrinal content of the new Church of England, the Protestant Church of England, it hardly differed in any fundamental respect from the rituals and the ceremonies of the old Roman Catholic religion. The fundamental difference, of course, was instead of the Pope being the head of the Church, it was the King of England, it was Henry VIII himself. Now, when Henry died, he was succeeded by his young son, Edward, who was a convinced Protestant. The Protestant party was in the ascendant at that time, and they did carry out quite a serious reformation, or started to do so. But of course, the king died young, Henry's son died young, and he was replaced by Mary, Henry's daughter by his first marriage, from Catherine of Aragon, who of course was a fanatical Catholic, known to history as Bloody Mary. It's not just a drink of vodka and tomato juice. This woman actually existed and attempted to put the clock back through a Catholic reaction, which killed quite a few people, not on the scale of the continent. The terrible massacres during the 30 Years' War, but nevertheless a serious Catholic reaction. Again, she was replaced at her death by Elizabeth, who again tilted in the direction of Protestantism. Elizabeth, of course, was not the most popular woman with the Roman Catholics because of her support for Protestantism. In fact, the Pope put out several bulls, I think they're called, papal bulls, demanding her assassination, and there were attempts to assassinate Elizabeth, who had, of course, at her disposal quite a ferocious regime of repression, of spies, of provocateurs, led by Walsingham. Now, on Elizabeth's death, of course, the new monarch, because she didn't have any children, they invited the King of Scotland. King James of Scotland was invited to take the English throne. James, interestingly enough, he's quite an intelligent man, as a matter of fact. He was quite clever, at least. Unlike his stupid son, Charles I, who lost his head as a result of his stupidity. But anyway, James originally was a Catholic, was strongly inclined towards Roman Catholicism. However, in order to take the English throne, which was a very tempting offer, he dropped his principles. You know, as they say, all right, if you don't like my principles, I'll change them. Well, he did. He changed not only his principles, he changed his religion. Similar as the King of France, Henry the Fourth, who had been a Protestant and embraced Catholicism. He went the other way. He dropped Protestantism and became a Catholic in order to occupy the French throne. And when somebody criticized him for this, he replied, Paris vaut bien une messe. Paris is well worth a mass. Well, I suppose James of Scotland thought that the possession of the English throne was well worth changing his religion, which he did. Now, the announcement that James was going to come and occupy the throne was well received by the Catholics, who were an oppressed minority at that time, quite severely repressed in England. They saw James coming to the throne as their great opportunity to put the clock back, to restore the good old religion, the Catholic religion, links with Rome. The Jesuit priests and so on, they were all quite thrilled by this. And therefore, just imagine their colossal disappointment when James dropped them, which he did. There was an order issued, by the way, to very soon after James came to London, to exclude, to expel all the Jesuits and Catholic priests from England. And therefore, you can imagine the indignation with which this news was received. And this is at the basis of the notorious Gunpowder Plot, a plot that was hatched by a number of disgruntled Catholic minor nobility that were in effect. And really speaking, Guy Fawkes, who is well known to every child and every adult in Britain, for the last 300 years, he's been ceremonially burnt on the 5th of November. Actually, Guy Fawkes was not the leading element in this plot. He was the practical man, if you like. He'd had military experience, of course, as I've said, in the Netherlands, was skilled in artillery. I think he was an artillery officer, if I remember correctly. And therefore, he was the perfect man to handle large quantities of gunpowder, which is the requisite instrument for blowing up the English establishment and killing, of course, King James. He wasn't the leader, but he was the front man. He suffered quite severe torture in order to... He was quite courageous, by the way. So courageous was. You have to pay tribute to the man as a man, as an individual. When he was arrested, the plot was discovered. Apparently, it was discovered by an accident. Apparently, one of the conspirators wrote to his relative, I think it was his father-in-law, who was a Catholic noble, who was due to attend the state opening of Parliament, sent him a letter saying, look, for goodness sake, stay away. Don't be in Parliament at that day, without giving any reasons for it. Whereupon this particular noble, who was probably out to save his own skin and was suspicious at this dinner, handed it over to the authorities, who investigated, gave a thorough investigation of the House of Commons, of the cellars in particular, discovered the gunpowder and arrested a man who gave his name as, I think, John Johnson. Of course, this was Guy Fawkes giving false information. He was, of course, threatened with torture, was arrested, interrogated, and in fairness to the man, he was quite courageous. He didn't denounce any of his fellow conspirators. He was honest, was loyal enough to them, not to give information. Even King James, who was following the interrogation, was sufficiently impressed by him to say that he showed a real Roman courage, I think was the expression that he used, Roman resolve. Yes, but this admiration did not prevent King James from instructing them to use torture, which was illegal under English law, except if the king were to give his permission for its use. So the unfortunate Guy Fawkes was subjected to torture. One can imagine the horrors that he would have experienced, probably hung up by his wrists, by iron manacles, and ultimately, of course, subjected to the horrors of that terrible thing, the rack, where you were torn, literally torn limb from limb. It was too much even for him to tolerate, and therefore finally he did confess to the existence of this plot. He was executed, naturally, and the other conspirators also, one way or another, were taken out, I think is the modern expression, either were shot or executed or whatever. And thus ended this notorious gunpowder plot. Now, the intention of the conspirators was, A, to blow up the entire English establishment, kill the king, but the main intention was to provoke an insurrection, to provoke a Catholic insurrection, which they signally failed in doing. The plot itself, as I say, was discovered, was aborted, and there was absolutely no indication of any support or any active support on the part of English Catholics, which nevertheless didn't mean that they weren't blamed for this. And of course, the anti-Catholic agitation, the hysteria generated, led to a fresh wave of persecution of Catholics, who subsequently, of course, were denied all their rights. Even the right to vote, I think, was only given to them in the early part of the 19th century. And therefore, this thing that we are celebrating, actually, on the 5th of November, was originally, and for some time maintained its character, as an anti-Catholic manifestation. It was an attempt to whip up popular feeling, popular hatred, popular feeling in favour of the monarchy, and particularly against the unfortunate Catholics. As a matter of fact, there's one place in England still to this day, there may be others, but there's one that I know of, the most famous one, is in Lewes, in Sussex, not far from Sussex University, where I used to study many years ago. They still, on the 5th of November, they don't burn Guy Fawkes. They burn an effigy of the Pope. And the entire thing, although it's quite spectacular, and I find it, once I ever went to it, it's a particularly macabre ceremony, whereby people imitating Catholic cardinals and bishops spouting their heretical views, according to the Protestant version, anyway. Quite a macabre and sinister event, I must say. Although, of course, to be fair, in this day and age, very few people know what they're celebrating. Hardly anybody, I think. I don't think you can seriously maintain, with the exception perhaps of some elements of this business in Lewes, it's not these days associated with any anti-Catholic sentiments as a rule, but it's just a way of kids having fun with fireworks and bonfires and penny for the guy, they used to say. I don't know what they say these days. Wouldn't get much for a penny. But that's the background of this interesting phenomenon, which still exists. And I don't think that we need to worry too much about the political and religious aspects of it. And therefore, I would wish all of our people who follow Marxist.com in England, that is, in Britain, to have a very enjoyable bonfire night. Don't drink too much and be careful with fireworks.